Okay, I'm back. Can you guys see me now? Are you guys able to see me? Yes, the internet started acting up. That devil don't want me to talk about this. He already know. He already know. It's all right. We back. And those that come back, they come back. And those they don't, then they'll catch it. They'll listen to the video. But yeah, we're talking about the altars. About what is an altar? What does an altar do? And that's what we was talking about. Okay, so let me go back. Okay, it says. Hold on a second, you guys. It says godly altars designed for sacrifices, worship of God Almighty, Exodus 20 and 24. An altar on earth thou shalt make unto me, and shalt sacrifice thereon thy burnt offerings and thy peace offerings, thy sheep and thy oxen. In all places where I record my name, I will come unto thee and I will bless thee. So altars, because I know yesterday somebody was asking me about an altar. They didn't know what an altar was. So I'm going to explain what an altar is real quick so they know, because they didn't know. They was like, what is an altar? And I was like, this is an altar. Let me tell you what an altar is. An altar is somewhere, some place where you go and pray. You build an altar in your home. Like I know Pastor Carmen has one in her room. She goes in her room and pray. That's her altar. That's where she prays. Mine is in my room and then and also the living room. Because I'm always here. I'm always teaching here. So I know this is part of my altar. Sometimes I can feel the spirit of God really strong here. So this is my altar. So a lot of people don't understand what an altar is. An altar is a place where you go and pray. Where you seek the Lord and you pray. That's what an altar is. So we need to know that that's what an altar is. Some people don't know. And it says to be made on earth an unhew stone. Exodus 20, 24, and 25. An altar on earth thou shalt make unto me, and thou shalt sacrifice thereon unto burnt offerings and thy peace offerings, thy sheep and thy oxen. In all places where I record my name, I will come unto thee and I will bless thee. This is back then they used to, you know, kill animals and stuff. They used to kill animals because that's what they, when they did wrong, somebody would come and they would build an altar and they would kill an animal. So that way God wouldn't punish them. God wouldn't come and do stuff to them for doing the things that they did. So they would use altars for that. So if thou will make me an altar of stone, thou shalt not build it of hewn stone, for it thou lift up thy upon it, thou hast polluted it. For if thou lift up thy tool upon it, thou polluted it. So ungodly altar. Ungodly altars are designed for idolatry. Idolatrous worship, often erected on roofs of houses. Whoa. A roof of houses? I didn't know that. But it says altars designed for idol, like to do an idol, is on, it says worships often erected on the roof of houses. So let's go to 2 Kings real quick so I can see what it's talking about. 2 Kings 23 and 12. 23 and 12. Let's see. 23 and 12 says. It says, and the altars that were on the top of the upper chamber of Ahaz, which the king of Judah had made, and the altars which Melchizedek had made in the two courts of the house of the Lord, did the king beat down and break down from hence and cast out dust of them into the brook of Kendra. And then 13 says, no, and then Jeremiah. So it's saying that the king built an altar on the top of the roof, which is an idolatry according to what God is saying. That's an idolatry. They shouldn't be, they're not supposed to be building that. It says, in the altars that were on top of the roof chamber of Ahaz, which the king of Judah had made, and the altars which Malchishah had made in the two courts of the house of the Lord, did the king beat down and break them down from thence and cast the dust of them into the brook. So they tore it down and cast it into the brook. Jeremiah 19 and 13. 19 and 13 says, let's see what it says. It says, and the houses of Jerusalem and the houses of the king of Judah shall be defiled as the place of Tophet, because of all the houses upon whose roofs they have burnt an incense unto all the host of heaven and have poured out drink offers unto other gods. See, people could be burning incense. It could be burning incense to what? To which God? To God, or to other gods? 32 and 29 says, Jeremiah 32 and 29 says, and the cherubims that fight against this city shall come and set fire on this city. The cherubims. And burn it with the houses upon whose roofs they have offered incense unto Baal. And poured out drinks of offering unto other gods to provoke me to anger. So there we go. We have people that do ungodly things and they burn these incense and they do it to make God angry. This makes God angry. Designed for idolatrous worship to be destroyed. Exodus 34 and 13 says, but ye shall destroy their altars, break their images, and cut down their groves. Deuteronomy 7, 5 and 9 says, but thus shall be ye deal with them. Ye shall destroy their altars and break down their images and cut down their groves and burn their graven images with fire. For thou art in a holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are upon the face of the earth. We've been chosen by God. The Lord did set his love upon you, nor chose you because ye were more in number than any people. For ye were the fewest of all people. He chose you because you were special to him. That's basically what he's saying. He said, the Lord did not set his love upon you, nor chose you because ye were more in numbers than any people. For ye were the fewest of all people. But because the Lord loved you and because he would keep the oath which he had sworn unto your fathers, have the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you out of the house of bondmen from the hand of the Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Sometimes you got to pray against that spirit of Pharaoh. Obviously, there's got to be that spirit, because look at what happened to in the Old Testament. That Pharaoh, that spirit would not let the people go. No matter what they did, it wouldn't let the people go. God had to go to the extent of doing so many different things to him that he finally let the people go. His son died. I mean, he went to the extreme. But God still got what he wanted. And God still will get what he wants today from us. Whether, you know, because people say, well, God is not going to force you. No, he doesn't force you, but he can make your life very hard. He can make your life very hard, and he can take everything from you. Take everything from you and make you start from nothing all over again because you won't obey him. The Lord did not. Okay, let me go. I'm sorry. I went too far. Because God loved you. So now, before the Lord thy God, he is God, the faithful God, which keepeth commandment mercy with them that love him and keep his commandments 2,000 generations. Visions and revelation. 1 Corinthians 2, 8 and 9 says, which none of the princes of this world knew. For had they known it, they would have not crucified the Lord of glory. Prayers against evil altars. We know the value of the blood of Jesus. It is against this background, not by power, not by might, but by the spirit of the blood that was shed on the cross, Calvary, that I am taking this bold step to pull down and burn off all altars from the pit of hell behind any problems in your life. because a lot of these problems are coming from these altars. We cover and envelope ourselves with the blood of Jesus as we go into these, and we go into prayer. We command any foundation hit, written, fueling the altars of our problems to be deleted now forever. And in mighty name of Jesus, our altars, the altars of God, arise and swallow these altars from the spirit and satanic human beings in the name of Jesus. Because there are human beings that are building altars. They're actually praying on altars so you don't get blessed. I set on fire every negative altar working to overflow, overthrow us, and destroy our destiny in Jesus' name. Every diver's fee on our head be canceled. The diver's fee on behalf of our children, entire family be wasted in the mighty name of Jesus. We destroy by fire every agreement between Balaam and Balak and to hinder us in the mighty name of Jesus. We loose ourselves from the grip of any evil altar holding our life in the mighty name of Jesus. But it is written, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. We thank the Lord God Almighty for what you have prepared for us. We believe they are there for us. We know that no altar of wickedness will be able to tamper with us again as long as we remain in the Lord Jesus Christ. A lot of people are in trouble because they come out, they get out of God. They get out of the Lord. They be in God for a little while and then they start praying and an attack start coming and then they start pulling away. But that's a trick of the enemy. He calls you to pull away when the trials start coming. I stand on the authority in the name of the blood of Jesus to burn down any altar erected anywhere on earth's surface, working to deny us of the blessings. Any altar fighting against us from the land, underneath the earth, the sea, the air, and the forest, and the junctions, covenants, and the cults, etc., must hear the commandments of the Lord concerning them. According to Deuteronomy 7, 5, and 9, we have been mandated by the Lord, the great I am, the mighty, terrible one, the lion of the tribe of Judah, the most righteous one, to pull all of you down and utterly destroy you all. And that's the word of God. Deuteronomy 7, 5 through 9. But thus shall ye deal with them. Ye shall destroy their altars and break down their images and cut down their groves and burn their graven images with fire. Thou art an holy people unto the Lord God, and the Lord thy God have chosen thee to be the special people unto himself. Above all people are upon the face of the earth. A bomb and burn down evil. Any evil altar working against us from the air, land, sea, forest, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Bomb and burn to ashes any evil altar working against us from our lineage. God bless you, Bridget. Our lineage. Any altars that's been being built that's coming against us from our lineage. We burn it down today. We burn it down today. From our father's house, our mother's house, from our in-law's house, from unfriendly friends, from any hidden place of wickedness, etc., in the name of Jesus. Unfriendly friends. Altars of failure making our life endeavors to be null and void must be burnt down into ashes in the mighty name of Jesus. Altars that have refused to let us go must hear this. But thus says the Lord, even the captives of the mighty shall be taken away. And the prey, the prey of the terrible shall be delivered. For I will contend with him that contends with thee. He will contend with them that contend with you. And he will save thy children. Isaiah 49, 25. So therefore I am breaking out. I am storming out by fire and by thunder in the mighty name of Jesus. You clever altars hiding and troubling our lives, come out now, be destroyed in the mighty name of Jesus. We choose these prayer points to fight against these altars. Altars that promote bondage of any kind. Altars of educational failure. Altars of poverty. Altars of barrenness. Altars of madness. Altars of confusion. Altars of uncompleted projects. Altars of backsliding. Altars of sadness. Altars of material barrenness. Altars of wickedness, of trouble, of lack and fear. Altars of death, altars of untimely death. Altars of cheating and lying. altars of fornication and adultery, altars of the lust of the flesh, altars of anger and rage in our lives, altars of sickness and disease, altars of blindness, altars of foolishness, of drunkenness, altars of divorces and marriages, altars of late marriages in the family. I'm telling you, the enemy's such a liar. Altars of unbelief, of laziness, altars promoting bad luck, altars of pornography, altars promoting polygamy, altars of the pit of hell, altars of no progress. You're trying, and you just can't progress. Altars that limit your movement up, altars of social weakness, altars of hate and misrepresentation, altars of blood. Exodus 34 and 13. But ye shall destroy their altars, break their images, and cut down their groves. Numbers 23 and 21. God bless you, Elizabeth. Listen to what the Lord is telling you. This is who you are. But ye shall destroy their altars, break their images, and cut down their groves. And that's Exodus 34 and 13. Numbers 23 and 1 says, and Balaam said unto Balak, build me here 7 altars and prepare me here 7 oxen and 7 rams. Numbers 23 and 14 says, and he brought him into the field of Zophim to the top of Pisgah and built 7 altars and offered a bullock and a ram on every altar. Numbers 23 and 29. And Balaam said unto Balak, build me here 7 altars and prepare me here 7 bullocks and 7 rams. Deuteronomy 7 and 5 says, but thus shall ye deal with them. Ye shall destroy their altars, break their images, and cut them their groves, and burnt their graven image and with fire. And we break and burn them down today. Every graven image, every altar that's been prayed against us, everything that we've been prayed about, everything that we just called out in Jesus' name, by the power and authority that's given to us by Jesus Christ, we tear it down today. Deuteronomy 12 and 3. Ye shall overthrow their altars and break their pillars and burn their groves with fire. And ye shall hew down the graven image of their gods and destroy the names of them of out of that place. Thank you, Jesus. I know this thing is crazy. Overthrown Hebrew, break down. Judges 2 and 2. And ye shall make no league with the inhabitants of this land. Ye shall throw down their altars, but ye have not obeyed my voice. Why have ye done this? 2 Chronicles 14 and 3. A lot of things are happening because people are not obeying God. They're going, doing whatever they want to do. Some of them say they're hearing God, but they're not hearing God. Because I told you what the young lady was saying. She heard something that Dr. Lovey was saying, and then she took it upon herself to go and do something, and she's telling a young lady who's got a boyfriend who's not married that, yeah, she should just go eat an apple and have a baby, and she's not married. No wisdom. Where's the wisdom there? You don't tell anybody. The people he tells to do that are married couples. They're people that have a husband or a wife. He's not telling folks to go out here and just do this. So there's no wisdom there. No wisdom. We got to have wisdom. For he took away the altars of the strange gods and the high places and break down the image and cut them the groves. 2 Chronicles 14 and 3. 2 Chronicles 23 and 17 says, and then all the people went to the house of Baal and break it down and break his altars and his images in pieces and slew Madian, the priest of Baal, before the altars. God don't play with these altars. The second Chronicles 30 and 14 says, and they arose and took away the altars that were in Jerusalem, and all the altars of incense took they away and cast them into the brook Kindrum. God don't be playing with these altars. 2 Chronicles 31 and 1. Now when all this was finished, all Israel that were present went out to the cities of Judah and break the images in pieces and cut down the groves and threw down the high places and the altars out of Judah and Benjamin and Ephraim also and the Messiah until they had utterly destroyed them all. Then all the children of Israel returned, and every man to his possession unto their own cities. So he destroyed. God said to destroy them altars. We shouldn't have them. We need to destroy them. They're not to be, we're not to have them at all. They're to be destroyed. We're not to have any of these altars. Any of them. We're not to have these altars. The devil is a liar. And as he built altars in the house of the Lord, where the Lord had said, in Jerusalem shall my name be forever. 2 Corinthians 33:4. So building an altar means for you to actually have somewhere in your home where you can pray to God and you commune with God. But there are also evil altars. So we got to be careful with that. Make sure you know that you know what kind of altar you're dealing with. Because sometimes it be evil altars. We got to be careful. Very careful with that. Because the devil is a liar. And he comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He doesn't care how he does it. He don't care how he does it. He's going to use whoever he can and whoever wants to be used by him. That's what he's going to do. He's going to use whoever he wants. Remember, the enemy uses bodies. It's people, when people coming against you, he's using a warm body to attack you. He has to use a vessel, something to attack you with. He just don't come out the air. He got to use somebody to tear you down, to talk about you, to make you look bad or say bad things about you. That's what he does. But when that person is doing that, you know there's a demonic spirit just using them. Because we shouldn't be doing that anyway. 2 Corinthians 33:15. And he took away the strange gods and the idol out of the house of the Lord and all the altars that he had built in the mount of the house of the Lord and Jerusalem and cast them out of the city. So what I'm telling you is there are idols in the house of the Lord. There are people that are worshiping idols in the house of the Lord. Could be a person. People could be very controlling, want to force you to do things. I know people right now, I'm not going to name any names, that have backslidden. Backslidden. And it's obvious. It's obvious. You can see it a mile away. You're trying to stay away. You don't want to be around. You come and go here and there. But you're backslidden and you need to get back into God completely, fully before he comes. Because he's coming. God forbid. God forbid that you found not in his will when he comes. And they break down the altars of Baalism and the presence of the images that were on high above them. He cut them down in groves and carved images and the molten images. He breaks in pieces. He made dust of them and strewed it upon the graves of them that had sacrificed unto them. God don't like this image stuff. 2 Chronicles 34:5. That's what I'm getting out of this. And he burnt the bones of the priests upon their altars and cleansed Judah and Jerusalem. I know one thing that I've read a lot about is when God comes to get somebody about something, back then he would kill the whole family. It wouldn't be just you. If you committed to sin, it would be just you. But back then he would get the whole family. The whole family would go. He wipe out the whole family. Psalms 84:3. Yea, the sparrow hath found an house, and the swallow a nest of herself, where she may lay her young, even thy altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Isaiah 17:8 says, and he shall not look to the altars, the work of his hands, neither shall respect that which his fingers have made, either the groves or the images. Isaiah 36:7. But if thou say to me, we trust in the Lord our God, it is not he whose high places and whose altars Hezekiah have taken away, and said to Judah and to Jerusalem, ye shall worship before this altar. Isaiah 64:3 says, and a people that provoke me to anger continually to my face, that sacrifices in gardens and burneth incense upon altars of bricks. So for those that say that God doesn't get angry and he won't get you, let me read it again. Because I hear a lot of people saying, oh, God, and yeah. Isaiah 65:3 says, a people that provoketh me to anger continually to my face, that sacrifices gardens and burns incense upon altars. So he does get angry, and he will get you. And your altar shall be desolate, and your images shall be broken, and I will cast down your slain men before your idols. And he will cast you down before your idols. So if you have an idol, better ask God, do you have an idol? Lord, search me, because I don't want no idols. He will get you. He said it in his word. I didn't say it. Isaiah 65:3. Ezekiel 6:5 says, and I will lay the dead carcass of the children of Israel before their idols, and I will scatter your bones around about your altars. This was in the Old Testament. Now, it's a little different in the New Testament, but I believe God still gets you. You're still going to be consequences. Ezekiel 6:6. In all your dwelling places, the cities shall be laid waste, and the high places shall be desolate, that your altars may be laid waste and made desolate, and your idols may be broken and ceased, and your images may be cut down, and your works may be established. Because Ephraim have made many altars to sin, altar shall be unto him a sin. I got a few more and we're done. Hosea 10:1 and Hosea 10:8. The high places also of Avon, the sin of Israel, shall be destroyed, and the throne and the thistle shall come upon on the altars. And they shall say to the mountains, cover us, and to the hills, fall on us. Amos 3:14. That in the day that I shall visit the transgressions of Israel upon him, I will also visit the altars of Bethel, and the horns of the altar shall be cut off and fall to the ground. And I believe God is talking about altars, period, for anybody. You shall deal with the wicked men and women and the wickedness behind the sea of the altars being erected by Satan and his agents. So we know they're going to be destroyed. Jesus, the Son of God, has set us free. No altars, no divination, nor enchantments will work on us anymore. Rather, arrest them in the name and the blood of Jesus Christ. Their altars can't work against us, but if you're not living right and you're doing stuff you ain't got no business doing, the door is open. And you're not going to tell me it's not. It's open. Even Benny Hinn said, the reason why people got demons is because they opened up a door. The door has been opened. And when you open up these doors, you're going to get what you're going to get. And it's not nothing to play with. It's serious. Reporting altars. This is the kind of altars where the name of a person is chanted. Some of you wasn't here yesterday, but you can go back. I stopped at 5. So now I'm going to finish reading what the altars are. These are different altars. They're different. Okay, so I'll just go tell you what the first one is. There's crossroad altars. And then there's tree altars. There's photographic altars where they take pictures of you. They do things with your pictures. Image altars. Symbols are made to represent a person or something in the spirit world. And whatever they do to that symbol may happen to the person in the spirit. Reporting altars. This is the kind of altar where the name of a person is chanted at all times. Victims of reporting altars would be hearing their names without knowing who is calling them. However, if they answer, they immediately fall prey. Clothing altars. This case where evil people lay hands on clothes of their victims for evil purposes. So if you know that somebody had cut away some portion from any of your clothes, or your underwear was once stolen, or your clothes got missing, mistressly, you need to embark on aggressive prayer. That's why we shouldn't be wearing people's clothes. Don't be sharing no clothes. People say, I go to the thrift store. That's fine, go. But you better pray over that stuff you got going on. You better pray over it. You better pray over it. You better pray. Okay? Because you don't know where it came from, who had it. You don't know who had it and who done prayed over it and what they did to it. You don't know. And because you don't know. Okay, hold on. This devil is a liar. I'm telling you. Okay, let me go back because something just happened. It took me off of. Okay, here we go. Clothing. River altars. There are altars meant to serve water demons. River altar. There are altars meant to serve water demons. They sit on people's lives and keep them. See how the internet keep messing up? It's all good. We're going to get this out today. Forest altars. Many people do not know that destroyers do not sleep. They are always busy operating in the forest at night, doing evil with people's names. Body part altars. Things like placenta, hair, are used to destroy lives. Astral altars. There are people who utterly evil words against the stars of others in order to render their lives unfruitful. Altars of evil transfer. Satanic priests and priests, spiritual robbers at the altars of evil transfer people's virtues. That's why I don't let everybody lay hands on me. I don't care. You could tell me you saved. I don't care. I see you saved. I see you doing what you're doing, but you won't be touching me. I don't care. God tells me don't let you touch me. You're not touching me. I am not playing no games. I'm telling you. This is why people are like, she thinks she better. No, I don't think I'm nothing, but I'm smart. I'm smart enough to know that I already experienced some of this crazy stuff, and I'm not trying to go through it again. I'm smart enough to know that. Family shrines. Any family with shrines has an altar, and the whole family members are monitored through that. I once prayed with a sister with a pathetic case. Her mother-in-law brought an idol from their village, from wherever she was, you know. This is people from Africa, people from Brazil, people from different countries, people out here in America, in cities. They go to these psychics and all of these people and get all these stupid stuff that they tell them to do. Get some hair from her. Get a piece of clothes. I'm telling you. I once prayed, and it says, and her mother-in-law brought in an idol into their sitting room for 3 months before she went back with it. While the thing was there, the woman created traffic of demons in her home. Through this, the mother-in-law now has some evil spirits that were monitoring the sister's home and giving them information for evil purposes. It took a great deal of prayer of deliverance to destroy the effect of the idol. When I asked her why her husband could not get rid of the thing, she said that immediately her mother-in-law brought it in. He turned to a spiritual draft, and it was as if he never went to church before. Physical altars. This is the type of altar where they sacrifice people that are kidnapped. This stuff is going on, y'all. Let's just stop thinking that this stuff is not happening. It's happening. Every day, it's happening. I know a brother who fell in a victim of this terrible altar. When he woke up, he discovered that his son had thrown his daily guide into the dustpan, and that was how he felt for the office without doing this normal quiet time. On getting onto the bus stop, somebody emerged from where slapped his chest, and as a result, he began to follow him. He was taken to a bush where there was a satanic priest with assorted human parts, which littered the surrounding of the altar. As they were preparing for him, the Lord told him to start praying in the spirit. As he began to speak in tongues, they became confused. When he saw that he intensified the praying in tongues, and before long, they all took to their heels, and he was able to escape. This is an example of a physical altar. Altar of curses. An example will serve explain this. Somewhere in Ondo state of, this is Nigeria, a man boarded a bus and the fare was 15 naira. He took the old 1 naira note, which has the color of the culture 10 naira note, and joined it with the normal 5 naira note, settled his fare. The conductor did not discover this trick immediately until after a long time during the trip. Eventually, the driver discovered it and demanded to know the culprit, but all the computers denied. The driver got annoyed, brought it out a horn with viper's tooth, and used some terrible curses with it. He said the person who did it would bury his children. Then he folded the old man narrow and threw it into the bush. And as he was throwing it, he also added that as the note was being thrown away, that the culprit would never prosper. Of a truth, these curses began to happen to the fellow. He noticed that his brilliant son suddenly became a dotard. He then started to search for the driver, and when he found him, the driver said he had thrown the thing into the forest and solution could only come if he could find it. The man could not find it, but he ran to Jesus. What did the driver do? He simply erected an altar of curses against that man. And there's people doing that right now. Beloved, Christian life is a spiritual warfare. If Jesus Christ, the purest man that ever lived, had enemies, it is certain that we will have enemies as well. But there are different strategies in Christian warfare. You could lay ambush, mount a frontal attack, launch a night attack, or do consistent bombardment for afar. However, nothing is terrible as fighting a war you do not understand. Some time ago, somebody showed me a film of the America Vietnam War. If you don't know what you're fighting, then how you're going to fight it? If you don't know what spirit you're fighting, how you're going to fight it? You got to know what you're fighting so you can fight it, right? And there's people out here that don't know what they're fighting. They're fighting all these stuff and don't know what they're fighting. I was one of them. I didn't know. I was like, what is going on? Until God began to reveal stuff to me. As I watched it, I almost started to cry because the Americans brought sophisticated weapons of Vietnam, but they could do little or nothing with it because their enemies were hiding on trees inside the waters with breathing tubes. Hence, the Americans could not see them. So the Vietnamese succeeded in what winning many of them. Eventually, the Americans abandoned the war because they did not understand the strategy of their enemies. In the same vein, if Christians do not understand the kind of battle they're in, they would be rendered useless. This is why I'm here, to teach you how to fight these demonic lion demons that's coming with all this stuff and we don't know what we're doing, and this is why we're getting in trouble. But our God has the capability to reduce our enemies to state of hopelessness within a second. Capacity. He has the capacity to reduce our enemies in a state of hopelessness within a second. The most difficult situation you may face gives God the greatest opportunity to show himself as the mighty God, because he has a lot of unusual weapons that can make us victorious. The unusual trend is that things might start getting worse before they begin to get better. And general reaction of people is to get discouraged and worry instead of taking the bull by the horn. Difficult times may be as a result of the penetration of a lot of enemies who must be expelled before there could be a relief. The fact is that the more the enemy boasts against a child of God, the greater is the fall shall be. The greater they're going to fall. How do we deal with evil altars? Recognize their operations, which we already explained the operations. If you guys want me to go over this again, I will do this again Tuesday, because it's really important that we get this. I told people to go back and listen to it again and again and again till it gets in your spirit. So when this stuff happens, you know something is going on. Repent of those things in your life that you are giving altars, evil altars, the platform to prosper in your life. Renounce them. It does not matter whether you know about them or not. Renounce them. Resist them using the words of God. Kill the priests of evil altar who are being used against you. It is an acceptable biblical practice to slay either evil priests or prophets through aggressive prayers. So don't let nobody tell you that you can't aggressively pray and tear them down. Yes, you can. Withdraw your benefits and virtues from the altars. Destroy the evil altars and give God praise. Furthermore, to destroy evil altars, you can curse them. You can call the fire of God or the divine hurricane of the Holy Spirit to blow them away. Every prayer against evil altars must be done aggressively and violently with faith. Embark now on the following prayer points. And the prayer points is this: render every aggressive altar impotent in the mighty name of Jesus. Every evil altar erected against us be disgraced in the name of Jesus. Anything done against us under demonic anointing be notified in the name of Jesus. I curse every local altar fashioned against us in the name of Jesus. Let the hammer of the Almighty God smash every evil altar erected against us in the name of Jesus. Oh Lord, send your fire to destroy every evil altar fashioned against us in the name of Jesus. Every evil priest ministering against us at evil altar, receive the sword of the God in the name of Jesus. Receive the sword of the Lord, the fire of God in the name of Jesus. Let the thunder of God smite all the evil priests ministering against us at the evil altars and burn them to ashes in Jesus' name. And if you want this, I will send it to you right now. I think I should send it to you. I think you should have it, and I'm going to send it to you. I'm sending it to you guys. The ones that are always on here, I will send it to you. The ones that come whenever they want to, they're going to have to figure that out. Sorry. But y'all, the faithful ones, I'm sending it to you. All of you. Because you need this. You need to know this. You need to know. You need to continue Okay, I'm sending it to you guys now. Elizabeth, you need to know. Sometimes people come on here and it's so crazy. They want to know what I'm doing, how I'm doing it. And I know that the Lord be telling me, and I'll be like, Lord, I don't care. These people got me twisted. They do. They really come on here to figure out what I'm doing and how I'm doing it. And they want to know all this stuff. But if you're not faithful, if you don't come here and you're not faithful, you know, I'm going to be led. If God tells me to share it, I will. And if he tells me not to share it, I won't. But I'm going to be faithful to those that are faithful to me. I love you. I really do. But I'm going to be faithful to the ones. Those are the ones that I'm going to look out for. Period. In the beginning, at first, because they're faithful. And because they're faithful, I believe that they deserve to receive everything. They come here, they sit here, they listen, they stay here with me all the time. Even when nobody shows up, they come and show up. They deserve to receive, I ain't going to say favoritism, but I'm going to say a little more grace. And I'm not being, you know, mean or nothing. I'm just telling you. That's how it is. That's how it is. Amen. They come and they learn. And I know they're going to be empowered by God. Because if God is empowering me as I'm teaching this, he's empowering each one of you. Each one of you are being empowered. So I sent it to pretty much everybody. And the ones that I miss, I will do it from my phone because it's kind of hard to do it from this thing. But God bless you guys today. I'm going to go ahead and go. God is good. I pray God's blessings over you this weekend. I pray God's unmerited favor. I pray that God will continue to open up our eyes, continue to give us discernment, continue to sharpen us, continue to give us more grace, God. Father, we pray for more grace, God. Give us the grace that we need, the power and authority that we need to continue to walk this walk and fight this fight of faith in the name of Jesus, oh God. God, we thank you this weekend. Give us a surprise. Surprise us, Lord. Surprise us with something. Surprise us with a blessing that we didn't even know we were going to get. Surprise us, Lord. Heal those that are sick in the mighty name of Jesus. I come against every sickness and disease right now. Every sickness and disease. And what the Lord's given me about sick, a lot of sicknesses is a distraction. The enemy brings that stuff because he wants to distract you. Because you doing good and you running for God. And then all of a sudden you feeling, because I'm telling you, I'm being attacked right now too with the same stuff. But I cancel the assignment in the name of Jesus. We are healed by the stripes of Jesus. We are healed. Even though we feel the symptoms, even though we're feeling it, we're healed. So that spirit of infirmity needs to go back to the pits of hell for where it came. And take everything that's attached to it and go in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Take everything with it and leave. Everything attached to it. In the mighty name of Jesus, we cancel the assignment of the enemy. He's a liar. He's a liar. Father, we thank you for good health. We thank you for we are healthy. We thank you, Father God, for every sickness and disease is bound on the cross in Jesus' name. It was bound on the cross. When you died, the sickness died with the cross. And we are healed by your stripes. We thank you. We thank you this morning. We thank you for blessing those that need a blessing, for those that need to be comforted, for those that are in prison, those that are in court, those that are in convalescent homes, those that are being trafficked. Father, I pray for your mercy and grace. Those that are in other children that are in children's hospital, those that are in juvenile hall, God, I'm asking you to move by your spirit. Send laborers across their pathway. Help us to minister to somebody today, God. Somebody might need to hear a word of encouragement. Somebody might need to see a smile. Somebody might need to say, God bless you. Somebody might need to know that God loves them. Help us to be that vessel in the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And we thank you today, God. We bless you and we thank you. We thank you for all that you're doing for us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you guys. God bless you. Love you.